Hey, we say, Jah Jah Yahweh. Serving the Lord. I don't know whether it's only the house, but that is serving the Lord. I don't know whether it is just your children that are serving the Lord, but Joshua is serving us this morning. But as for him and his own, they will serve the Lord. We are still in the moment of thanksgiving.
Amen.
The Bible says the enemy came to steal, kill, and destroy. But I have come that you may have life and have it in abundance. If you are so alive, it doesn't mean you are special. The Bible says the devil came to kill you, but you are so alive because of a reason. And that reason is Jesus Christ. He's the reason why you are still alive. It's not because you are handsome. It's not because you are beautiful. It's not because you got a cash in your account. It's not because you are educated than somebody else. No. But the reason is Jesus Christ. The Bible says it's sooner than the ones that are living God. It has seen for you, and the Bible says it's blasphemed. Better way than the blood of Abel. His blood is speaking on our behalf. His name is Jesus. He said, if I will be lifted up above all else, if I will be lifted up, if I will be praised, if I will be honored, if I will be glorified above all else. The singer said, if our praises are mounted up, if our singing goes up, then his blessing is down. Somebody who knows speaking tongues can speak in tongues right now. Jesus, a time is coming. What a true worship. We worship the Father in truth and in spirit. Because God is a spirit. We don't worship God physically. We worship God spiritually. Because He is a spirit. Make us Yangelias. In the name of Jesus. Mikarias Mia. In the name of Jesus. We glorify your name. We glorify your name. Oh.
Yeah.
sanctify your name. We set your name apart this morning. And we lift you up above all else. We deserve the glory, we deserve the honor. We give you the praise this morning. In the name of Jesus. Shall we say amen? Amen. Hallelujah. Praise and worship team. God bless you so much. Hallelujah. You're really warm up environments. Amen. We were kind of feeling a little bit dull. Amen. Amen.
Really?
God bless you so much. Amen. Now we're going to prepare ourselves for our tithe and offering. Hallelujah. Tithe and offering time. Hallelujah. I know we've enjoyed our Thanksgiving over the past weekend. Yes, we've spent a lot. Hallelujah. But I do believe, some way, somehow, we were remembered by the one-tenth portion which belongs to the Lord. Hallelujah. Amen. That is what we're going to give right now. Amen. Amen. I hope you are ready this morning. Amen. The Bible says one tenth of our earnings is what belongs to the Lord. Amen. Tithe and offering time. Hallelujah. As we prepare ourselves, I know the praise of worship team will prepare themselves again. They will come over, but before then, we will invite our apostle to lead us to pray before we give out our tithe and offering. Amen.
Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for our tithes and offering. Bless those that have it to give, those that doesn't but have a desire. Bless them. Press down, shake it together, running over. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. I will enjoy His great, great thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter His courts with praise. And I will sing, this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice, for He has made me glad. Something that's going to impact our lives, that's really going to leave a mark.
Amen.
Like I said earlier on, just this Friday, I learned something. That whatever you do on this earth, the map that you leave will really determine what really happens on the day that you say goodbye to the earth. Hallelujah. Fidel Castro was a very powerful man on this earth. Hallelujah. For six decades, over 60 years. Hallelujah. Even the United States CIA couldn't take him over. Hallelujah. That tells you the sort of person he was. Hallelujah. Yes. If America could take the lives of Saddam Hussein and Gaddafi away in just a minute, and for about 60 years, they could not take this man out. That tells you who he was. But at the end of the day, when he passed away, some people were just rejoicing. Hallelujah.
Amen.
That tells you on the side of the brutal life that he led. Hallelujah.
Amen.
But we, the children of God,
Amen.
Every step that we make on earth, I believe will leave a mark that will make people weep on the day that we say goodbye to this earth. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen. We're going to hear the word, but I don't know if Choir Master will give us one music before. Hallelujah. I know he's just cracking the veins. Hallelujah. You know what? That's funny. It's very funny when you're a teacher or a lecturer, you are teaching something before your students, and one of your students raises up his hand and tells you, sir, you are wrong. Hallelujah. When they started his first music, it was literally, he took the other side, and then I realized later, hey, you have to be on the track. Hallelujah. Amen. I want to say it's all good. Hallelujah. Choir Master, give us one song just to pray with for the message. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. You're going to sing a short song. Brackets, you know how to sing a song. Please come. Amen. Hallelujah.
Amen.
I said it, I'm saying it again. Joshua said, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord.
Yes.
Amen. If this is your power,
yes.
If this is your glory,
amen.
If this is your presence, amen. If this is your power, if this is your glory. Let it rain. Amen. If this is your power, let us reign. Hallelujah. If this is your power, let us hear something good this morning. Hallelujah. Without wasting my time, let us give it. Clap offering and welcome the hand pastor of Unlimited Grace Prayer Ministry. Hallelujah. Reverend Joe Luis Asamoah, as he comes over for what the good Lord has for us. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen.
We glorify your name. We glorify your name. Oh, my God, we glorify. We glorify. Church every day, every morning, every afternoon, and some of us, every time there is church service, we are there. Hallelujah.
Amen.
But if we don't go to heaven, it is meaningless. Amen.
Amen.
We can get all the breakthroughs through the prayers that we are praying.
Yes.
We can get all the anointing through the prayers that we are praying. We can be in the house of God and worship and people will fall and cry. We can be in the house of God and then begin to play the instruments and people will hear it and they begin to fumble and fall and cry. Hallelujah. But if we do not go to heaven, all of these things are in vain. Hallelujah. Amen. So it's important for us to know some of the things that can hinder us from going to heaven. Amen. And one of the things that can stop us from following Christ or from going to heaven is the spirit of provocation. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. Or provocation. Provocation. You know, most of us, if we observe, we see that people are moving from churches to churches, Why? Because they have become church prostitutes. They will come here, oh, I don't like this place. Tomorrow they'll be here. No, we don't like this place. The next day they'll be here. No, we don't like this one. Oh, today we like this one. Tomorrow we don't like this one. Why? Because most of them get provoked. Hallelujah. They got offended. And they left where God wants them to be.
Amen.
And no matter where they go, they are not satisfied because they are not being fed with, or they are not getting what God wants them to get. Hallelujah. And that makes it very sad that today we don't even acknowledge. It's a normal thing for people to get provoked. Hallelujah.
Amen.
It's a normal thing for people to get angry. Amen. It's a normal thing for people to get offended in certain things when you leave the church. Amen. And this is what is going on, and this is what is ruining the church in our days. And most people will not go to heaven because they are provoked. Amen. I went to one of my members' church and house, and they told me that many pastors will take people to heaven. Hallelujah. To hell. Than to heaven. And I told him that yes, that is true. But many pastors will take only unmature believers. Hallelujah. People that are not mature. But I don't believe that anybody that is mature in Christ will go to hell because of his or her pastor. Amen. Because your faith is not in the pastor. Amen. Your faith is not in the person that is sitting behind you. Amen. When you come to the house of God, you should come with a focus that you want to go to heaven. Amen. One of the things that will stop you or that will provoke you in the house of God, or one of the things that provokes people, or one of the means that people easily get provoked. Amen. Is the perception that they are having. Amen. The perception that they have in life. You know, perceptions that you have in life can easily get you what? Provoked or unprovoked. Hallelujah. What you are thinking about somebody. You know, this guy gets married. And as soon as he gets married, he walks out to a ball and meets her old fiancé. Hallelujah. The lady that she used to go out with. Then someone else who is with his wife's, her wife's friend, sees them standing at the ball. Then this person calls the wife. Hey! I saw your husband standing there with so and so. I heard they used to date. Hallelujah. They used to date together. And if you don't take care, so and so is going to take your husband from you. Hallelujah. As soon as he hears that call, it becomes a perception. He or she conceives the perception that so and so can take his husband from her. Hallelujah. So it could be that it is not even in the imagination of the his old fiancé has even never perceived that he will come between them. Hallelujah. Or the old fiancé respects marriage. So the old fiancé be like, oh, you are now married, so I don't want to come in between you. Hallelujah. But because someone just picked up a phone and told the other person, his wife, that if you don't take care, this person is going to snatch your husband from you. It creates a perception in the mind. And whenever he sees, she sees that this lady is standing there with her husband, she gets offended. Amen. Whether it is for genuine reasons or it is not for genuine reasons, this person gets offended. Why? Because she has perceived that lady can snatch the husband from him. Hallelujah. So perception is very important. Sometimes if we don't take care, we will be easily provoked and deceived to go against the will of God. Amen. That is why it is very important that we are conscious, aware of our perception. Hallelujah. For coming to the house of God. What is your perception? What is your intent? Hallelujah. You know, people meet and they love themselves. Hallelujah. But when they have issues in their marriage and they come for counseling, most of them, they'll be like, oh, pastor, leave him alone. I don't know how you say it in English. Amen. Leave him alone. He's getting on my nerves. Amen. Why is a person that you met from the beginning, that you loved, that you liked, and sometimes, as a matter of fact, you even still love him, but yet still, he or she is getting on your nerves? Hallelujah. And sometimes when you go deep in it, you will see that it's just a little gossip. Something that somebody told him or her that has made him or her perceive certain actions that the husband or the wife can take against him or her. And as a matter of fact, even by the time you act, he's thinking that this is what you are going to do. Before you act, he knows that this is what you are going to do. And he gets offended. Maybe you might meant it for good. Amen. Let's look at something in the Bible. The book of John. Hallelujah. Chapter 6. The book of John, chapter 6. Verse 22. Amen. Amen. Verse 22 now. On the following day, when the people who were standing, can you change my batteries for me? Hallelujah.
Amen.
Can you change my batteries for me? I don't like the sound. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. You can change the batteries for me. Amen. On the following day, when the people who were standing on the other side of the sea saw that there was no other boat there, except that one which his disciples had entered, and that Jesus had not entered the boat with his disciples, but his disciples had gone away alone. However, other boats came from Tiberias.
Amen. This one is not working
at all. Amen. Jesus answered them and said, "Most assuredly, I say to you, you seek me not because you saw the signs, but because you ate of the loaves and were filled." Hallelujah. We are going to continue from that. Amen.
Amen.
One time, Jesus went to a place, and a lot of the crowd followed Jesus. Then amen. God bless you. A lot of the crowd followed Jesus. Then Jesus saw that they were hungry. If you read from the beginning, Jesus himself asked the disciples, how are we going to feed these people? Do you think we have enough money to feed these people? You know, this is one of the most one of the scriptures that I read. I laugh a lot. Hallelujah. It's very funny scripture if you follow the verses. Amen. Then they said, oh, we don't have anything. We have only two fishes and five fishes and two loaves of bread. Hallelujah. Then Jesus prayed on it, blessed it, and they ate it. Amen. Then, verse 22 downwards. The next day, they came there seeking for Jesus. The same place that he blessed bread, and they break the bread and eat. When they came, Jesus was not there. Be that Jesus is not there, but he has gone to the city and he will be back. Hallelujah. But the Bible said that there was no boat. Amen. Around. You know, most of the time, some of you, when you are coming to the church, you are looking out, it's pastor's car there. It's, so if you see so, pastor is there. Hallelujah. Oh, I see Brahari's car. I know Brahari is with him. Hallelujah. This is what they were doing. They were looking for the boat that Jesus came with. And they did not saw the boat. Then they knew that Jesus has left their city. Amen. So they sat in other boats and went to the next city that is close by, which is Capernaum. Hallelujah. Knowing that by hours Jesus will be there. Amen. Why are they seeking for Jesus? Because of the bread that he ate and crossed to another country or town. Amen. Not thinking of why they receive. Not thinking of what will happen to them when they go there. But they knew that they were going to get what? Food. Amen. So their perception is that they were going to seek for Jesus so that Jesus will give them food. You know, your perception for coming to church is very important. You know, one way it is that people will come to church seeking for God and seeking for Christ. Amen. Nowadays, somebody will come to church and you say, oh, we have a counseling. Tell your problems. It will shock you. Somebody will come and tell you, pastor, I need a visa. The reason why this person is going to church is because he needs a visa. Amen. And it will shock you that that visa has taken that person to church for more than 5 years. Amen. It will shock you that somebody is coming to church and all his prayer requests is that, pastor, pray that there is this money that I'm looking for. I have do all that I can do to get this money, but this money is not going through, and I want you to pray so that I get this money. Pastor, if you pray for me and I get this money, the way I'm going to bless this church, you don't even know, you have no idea. When you pray for me and I'm able to get this money, I am going to be the full member of this church. I am going to support this church. I'm going to tithe in this church. He is coming to church because he wants the pastor to pray for him so that he will get the money that he's looking for. Amen. And when the pastor prays for him and he gets the money, he says, 3 months later, He's no more looking for money. He's looking for maybe another contract. Hallelujah. Pastor prayed and prayed and prayed and prayed and prayed. There was no contract. This pastor, the anointing is leaving him. The Spirit of God has departed from him. He can't even see anymore. Hallelujah. Then he began to get offended by any little action that the pastor does. Amen. Right now, his needs are not being met. What he needs is to get a contract. And his needs are not being met. So any little thing that the pastor does, he becomes offended. How many of you know that whenever your needs are not met, your needs are not met, your needs are not met, it's easy for you to get offended. Mm-hmm. Amen. Mm-hmm. You see, most married couples, when you are not able to satisfy your husband or your wife in bed,
Jesus,
if you like by him or her, build a mansion and put them in it, you will still get on their nerves. Amen. Why? Because you are not meeting their needs. Your perception for coming to the church is very important.
Amen.
Amen. And there is this spirit that causes people to have negative perception in the church. And it's stopping people from getting to Jesus or from getting to where God has originally ordained them to be in life. Amen. We are talking about the spirit of provocation. Amen. These people were seeking after Jesus that he will make bread for them again. Because yesterday he made bread for them. Amen. Some of you, no matter how good I will be, no matter how good another pastor or another church member will be to you, you will still leave the church. Why? Because your expectations, your desire, hallelujah, your perception, your needs are not being met. And what are your needs? Amen. It will shock you that some people came to the church just because they thought that there is this guy in the church that they can have an advantage with. Or there is this lady in the church that they want to have an advantage. Hallelujah. So they came to church just to fall in love with a person. Amen. And when they come to the church, and by the grace of God, they are able to have contact with this lady. They speak to this lady. We want to go out with you. The lady will say, oh, I'm praying about it. The next day, oh, I'm praying about it. The next 2 days, or the next 2 weeks, the same lady that you have been chasing around in the church, that has been saying, I'm praying about it, I'm praying about it. Another gentleman appears in the church. Maybe you have a good job than the person. You have a fine job than the person. Hallelujah. Maybe you perceive that you look better than the person. Then this man comes and says, oh, I want to go out with you. And you see that the next week, this lady that you have been chasing for years in the church. Another man just came to the church, and the next week he is going out with this lady. Hallelujah. Hey, what did this lady see about this man? Then we become offended. So anything that this man will do, hallelujah, sometimes this can create a perception that the girl hates us.
Jesus.
Amen. So even when he is doing something to show love to you, just because he did not go out with you, you get offended. Amen. Intelligent, and this man is very smart. Why did he even behave like this? Amen. The spirit of provocation, this spirit attacks your mind. Amen. That you are not able to reason well. That you will begin to have different kinds of perception that are not a reality. Amen. And it will take you outside from the will of God. Let's look at what happened. Jesus answered them and said, "Most assuredly I say to you, seek me not because you saw the signs, but because you ate of the loaves and were filled. Do not labor for the food which perishes, but for the food which endures to everlasting life." Amen. "Which the Son of Man will give you, because God the Father has set the seal on him." Hallelujah. Then they said to him, "What shall we do that we may work the works of God?" Amen. If you have a Bible, underline, "What shall we do that we may work the works of God?" Amen. Jesus answered and said to them, "This is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he sent." Therefore they said to him, "What sign will you perform then, that we may see it and believe you?" Hallelujah. "What work will you do? Our fathers ate the manna in the desert. As it is written, he gave them bread from heaven to eat." Then Jesus said to them, "Most assuredly, I said to you, Moses did not give you the bread from heaven, but my Father gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is he who comes down from heaven and gives life to the world." Hallelujah. Verse 34. "When they said to him, Lord, give us this bread always." Amen. "Then they said to him, Lord, give us this bread always." You see that from the beginning of the conversation, they begin to get excited. Hallelujah. And they said that, "Teach us what to do so that we will do the rest of God." The focus of Jesus, the purpose of Jesus, is that mankind will do the rest of God. The focus of the people is that they will get bread to eat. Amen. Amen. So Jesus was telling them about doing the work of God. Amen. And they wanted to receive Jesus. They wanted Jesus to know that, hey, we will do the rest of God.
Amen.
They said, "Teach us what we will do to do the works of God."
Jesus.
Knowing that when Jesus teach them, he will give them what? bread. So they will do whatever it takes to do the work of God, so far as they get the bread that they came for.
Amen.
In other words, that is what they were saying. They will do whatever it takes to do, so long as they get the bread that they came for.
Amen.
Amen. You know, there are some people, when they go to church, if you tell them to lie down, they will lie down. If you tell them to roll, they will roll. They will say, "Pastor, tell us what to do." But what entice you, Pastor? And you teach them that roll on the floor, and you are going to get your visa in 2 weeks. And 2 weeks time, he doesn't get a visa.
Jesus.
Hallelujah. Jesus. You are finished. Amen. His purpose is not the word of God or doing the work of God, but his focus is the fish, the food, the bread that they are going to get. Even though they were talking about doing the work of God, but their focus was not on doing the work of God. Amen. Most of us are here, even though we are talking of building the work of God, even though we are always saying it, that, oh, we will have the work of God, we will do the work of God. But that is not our focus. Our focus is that we will have our daily bread.
Amen.
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 And we get offended when we don't get our daily bread. We get offended. Pastor, pray for me that I get this job. Pastor, I've been praying for 3 years. I've not been getting this job. The anointing. Pastor, I don't nowadays I don't even see Pastor praying. I think Pastor don't pray for me anymore.
Jesus.
Amen. What am I even doing in this church?
Jesus.
If I go to a church and the pastor even does not pray for me.
Jesus.
Amen.
Jesus.
What am I even doing in this church?
Jesus.
If my pastor is not even coming to my house.
Jesus.
So you came to the church because you want me to come to your house.
Jesus.
Amen.
Amen.
So you come to the church because you want me to pray for you.
Jesus.
But you did not come to church to listen to the word of God.
Jesus.
But maybe what the Lord is speaking through me every Sunday to you, if you obey it, the blessing that will come in your life,
Jesus,
it is more than me coming to your house. Amen.
Amen.
But your focus is on me coming to your house.
Jesus.
Your focus is on me eating your food.
Jesus.
Your focus is that it's not just me, but your friend sitting behind you. Oh my God. When I went to the church, Mr. So-so-and-so was very close to me. He used to come to my house. We used to do everything together. Now he's no more. When I call him, he doesn't pick it. I hate people that pretend that they are believers. I can't even worship with them anymore. Why? Because I feel in my spirit that they don't love me. Oh, so you come to church so that we will love you. Hallelujah. If you come to church expecting that the people there will love you, then you got it wrong. Hallelujah. If you come to church expecting to have a better intimacy or a better relationship with a pastor, then you have it wrong.
Jesus.
We don't come to church to build better relationship with our pastors, to build an intimacy with our pastors, to build an intimacy with friends. Hallelujah. Even though they all come along as we come to church, but our main focus should be that we are striving towards heaven.
Amen.
Amen. And even if this friend is going to provoke me, I know what I'm looking for. And I'm not going to get offended with it.
Uh-huh.
Amen. Hallelujah. The perception that it came to Jesus with. Amen. The next thing that I'm going to talk about is their expectations. They did not came with a perception that Jesus was going to give them bread. Hallelujah. Amen. But they expected Jesus to give them bread. Mm-hmm. Because that is what happened yesterday. Amen. Amen. Yesterday, when we went and sit under Jesus' ministry and he preached the word of God, after he finished preaching, he gave us bread. Mm-hmm. Why is it that today he's not giving us bread? And he's sending us away home. No, leave him alone. Nowadays, Jesus has become so proud. Even when we go, he doesn't even take care of our needs. He doesn't even give us bread. We are tired of this Jesus. We are going. Hallelujah. You know, there's a saying that familiarity brings content. Amen. They were expecting that Jesus, they not only have the perception, but they also have a higher expectation that whatever happens, we are going to get bread. Oh, yesterday he gave us bread. This man has come to this here. Ohio. He is very powerful. Jesus. He is very anointed. Jesus. I know God is using this man.
Yes, yes.
And he came to this man. This man said, let us pray. I saw a vision and God opened my eyes and I saw that a chicken is having a big star scarf. Hallelujah. And this chicken is following you. And immediately this man began to see. This man is very powerful. Why? How was he able to see and determine that a chicken has a scarf following me? Hallelujah. Oh, maybe he sees a snake in a big shoe. Amen. Maybe a snake in McDonald's shoe or a Nike shoe chasing you. Hey, this man is very powerful. He has been able to tell me things. Oh, I need to go to this man. So we are always going to this man expecting that this man will tell us something. But we are not coming to church expecting that we will get a breakthrough. We come to church. Oh, there is this guy in church when he stands and sings. Oh, he is very anointed. Amen.
Amen.
Then this guy begins to sing. As soon as the guy begins to sing, your heart begins to melt. So 1 week later, you came back and pastor says, no, this guy is not singing anymore. Why are they not allowing so and so to sing anymore in the church? This pastor, you think that he is. And you begin to fabricate. Hallelujah. Amen.
Amen.
I remember when in Ghana, when we were kids, we were having our BEC. There is this guy can pray. Maybe some of you think that I can pray. This guy, when he stand and he pray, heavens will break loose. I know. Maybe it's not him, so I'll not mention his name. Amen. This guy can pray. Then after the BC, the results came. And it's not like there are some people, they can pray, but they're not smart when it comes to classroom work. Hallelujah. This guy was also smart in classroom work. He did his exam with a higher expectation that he is going to get 10 ones. Hallelujah. When the results came, this guy came to the school with pride. Hey, the answer was cheap. I know I'm going to win. I know I'm going to get 10 ones. bring you strength. Hallelujah. And this guy opened his results, and shockingly, this guy was winning around 15. Aggregate 15. This guy became mad. He said, God has disappointed me. I'm no more going to church again. I'm no more the way I study this thing. I did not only study, I pray. So his expectations was that because he has studied and prayed, he's supposed to have 10 ones. Or he's supposed to be on the dean's list. But he was not.
My God.
Then he became mad. I'm no more going to church again.
Jesus.
Amen.
Amen.
The spirit of provocation. It attacks our expectations.
Yes.
The Bible says that the devil comes to kill, to steal, and to destroy. Amen. It attacks our expectations that it will not come into a reality. Then we get provoked. Amen. Let's look at what happened. Then they said to Jesus, Lord, give us this bread always. Amen. Meaning they are getting excited. They want the bread. Hallelujah. They want the bread. You know, they twisted it fast. They said, Lord, give us this bread always. Amen. And Jesus said to them, I am the bread of life. He who comes to me shall never hunger. And he who believes in me shall never thirst. But I said to you that you have seen me and yet do not believe. All that the Father gives me will come to me. And the one who comes to me, I will by no means cast out. For I have come down from heaven. Hallelujah. Let me continue from 41. Then the Jews then complained about him. Because he said, I am the bread which came down from heaven. Amen. And they said, is not this Jesus, the son of Joseph, whose father and mother we know? Who is it then that he says, I will come down from heaven? Hallelujah. You see, these same people that were testing Jesus, saying that, hey, great man, great teacher, where have you been? We wanted to come to you so that you will teach us the ways of God. You will teach us how to work the ways of God. Hallelujah. Amen. When Jesus refused to give them what they want, and he said, I am what you want, you are expecting me to give you physical bread. But I don't have any bread for you anymore today. But I am the bread of life. If you take me, hey, who are you? When they were chasing him, you know, from the beginning, when they were asking him, that we want you to teach us so that we'll be able to do the works of God. Didn't they know that he was the son of Joseph? Hallelujah. Now they begin to look down upon him. The spirit of provocation will always let you miss your blessing. Some of you are going through what you are going through because things that were not supposed to get on your nerves begin to get on your nerves. Amen. You see, we are earnest and Linda is a wife. You see, but Linda said, maybe standing here. Hey, nowadays, when we cross, I see brother Ernest and Mavis. Every day they left last in the church. Why is it that? If we don't take care, brother Ernest, brother Ernest, Mavis will bring you down. So now, I am having that perception. And anytime I see Brother Ernest and Mavis together in the church, I get offended. Jesus. I don't even know what they are discussing. I don't even know what they are doing. But I get offended. Jesus. I don't have any facts. What is going to happen when I see them together? It looks like I should take something and hit Brother Eric on behalf of Peter. Amen. Brother Ernest on behalf of Peter. We become offended. The spirit of provocation. Somebody will just pick a phone. Just an ordinary phone. Oh! Don't you know? Pastor did this to me. And don't you know? Maybe he did that to me. And don't you know? Oh! The way Maybe says, so he can do, she can do all these things to you. The way she, every day, she's at church praying, and she did this to you. Hey, then I must take care of myself when I'm dealing with babies. Hey, I didn't know babies was like that. Perception. Hallelujah. Maybe the person told you that, oh, maybe step on my leg, and I was trying to ask him why you step on my legs, and maybe grow out of me. So the next time maybe comes to church, unknowingly, not knowing what you have discussed, he mistakenly stepped on your feet. Because you have already had that person. Oh, I'm sorry. The moment you go home, hey, today he stepped on my toes, me too, he stepped on my toes. Even the way she did her face and said, I'm sorry, I wish you were there. Hallelujah. Then it aggravates anger. Amen. So the next time something happens, even though directly, maybe it has not done anything wrong to them, but they already have a perception about maybe that every good thing that maybe should do, whether good or bad, they want to link it with their perception that they are having. Amen. And if you don't take care, what God is having for you, they are standing there with a creator. They are standing there with Jesus. They are following Jesus. You know, look, when this election was going on, some people, they were even ashamed of wearing Trump's this thing. But when Trump won, everybody, even people that you know, even vote for him, some of them are wearing his clothes. Hallelujah. And people that follow Trump are proud. That, oh, yes, we follow him. Hallelujah. You are following not just an ordinary person, but God reincarnated. But you get offended. You know, they got offended because of what Jesus said. Why? They did not just get offended because of what Jesus said, but they get offended because they already have a culture. Two, they already have a perception. Three, they already have an expectation which was different from what Jesus was expecting them to do, the rest of God. Hallelujah. You see how from the beginning of how they were like, oh, teach us what to do. We will do the rest of God. We will follow you. We will do this. But as soon as what Jesus said went against their culture, as soon as what Jesus said was not up to their expectations, as soon as what Jesus said made confirm their perception, he said, what kind of teachings is this? Hallelujah.
Amen.
I don't have time, so I will jump to verse 66. He said that from that time, many of his disciples went back and walked with him no more. Then Jesus said to the 12, do you also want to go away? Hallelujah. But Simon Peter answered him, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. Amen. And we have come to believe. Hallelujah. And know that you are Christ, the Son of the living God. Amen. He said that, yes, we are not leaving you. Even though they have left you, we are not leaving you because we know that you are Christ. Hallelujah. So you see here that there are two different kinds of people. The 12 that left, they said that they know that Jesus have eternal life. Meaning that they were seeking after what? Eternal life. Amen. And the other people, more than the 70 and the others, they were also seeking after what? Bread. Amen. Even though we see that they all said that we want to do the works of God. Amen. I believe that everybody that comes in the house of God wants to support the work of God, that the work of God might grow. Hallelujah. That the work of God will be effective. Hallelujah. People will come to church and sow money into the church so that the church will be able to do evangelism, pay their bills, and win souls for Christ. Amen. People will come to church, spend their time, do reza, and come and play the instruments, sing, worship, do ushering, and any other job in the church. What makes the difference? What makes the difference? It's not him that is able to sing for people to cry and weep. Hallelujah. It is not him that is able to stand on his feet and pray 24 hours non-stop. Hallelujah. It is not him that is able to stand on a pulpit and quote thousands of scriptures. Hallelujah. It is not him that is able to come and sow thousands of dollars into a ministry. Hallelujah. That makes the difference. But what makes the difference is your vision. mission, your focus, hallelujah. They focus on the bread, hallelujah. But the other disciples focus on eternal life. I pray today that somebody listening to me or somebody at the sound of my voice will change his focus and his perceptions and begin to focus on the things of God and begin to focus on eternal life and begin to understand that the things that we see are temporal, but the things that we do not see are eternal, and begin to focus on the things of God and expect that God is going to bless him whether he do good or he does not good in the house of God.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Your expectations is very important. Your focus is very important. Beloved, we are still talking about will you make it to heaven? Amen. If you are going to make it to heaven, you should be able to overcome the spirit of provocation.
Yes.
The people were provoked. Why? Because Jesus said that he's not going to give them bread.
Uh-huh.
Amen.
Amen.
The people were provoked. Because there was not going to be any bread anymore. Sometimes we get offended when our needs are not being met. Because our focus is on our needs. Amen.
Amen.
Sometimes we don't even know that our focus is on our needs until we are not able to meet our needs.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Beloved, let us focus on the things of God. Let us focus on eternal life.
Amen.
So, the only reason why the other 12 are saying that they did not leave is that they focus on what? Eternal life.
Yes.
Amen. You know, gone were the days when people will come to church with a perception that we want to speak in tongues. Hallelujah. Gone were the days that people will be chasing you, Pastor, pray for me that I will be able to speak and be filled with the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. Now people will be chasing you, Pastor, pray for me that I get a green card. Pastor, pray for me that I'm able to make money. Pastor, pray for me that I'm able to get a job. Hallelujah. But what it is that people will chase you, that they will get insights in the word of God. Amen. Trust me, this voice, sometimes even I don't hear it at all. Sometimes once in a year, that will hear somebody, Father, pray for me, Pastor, that I will be spirit-filled, that I will be able to go to heaven. When people are telling me their prayer request, no heaven, no. No heaven. Amen. Our focus is on money. Our focus is on how the pastor conducts himself. Me, as for me, I will not go to a pastor that the pastor do this and that. Amen. That should not be your focus. If the pastor do A and B, and the pastor is giving me a word that will take me to heaven, I will stay there. The pastor is helping my spiritual growth, I will stay there. Amen. The spirit of provocation. You know, most of us, we are provoked. Most of you, pastor, get on your nerves. Amen. It's, most of you, you know, you like pastor. Whatever happens, you like pastor. But pastor gets on your nerves because of what people are telling you. Most of you, you like Brother Eric. But Brother Eric is getting on your nerves because of what people are telling you. Oh, don't mind him. He is controlled by the wife. Everything that the wife will say, he just follows it. Don't mind him. So even if God through Brother Eric is giving you wise counsel, you say, oh, I think he's saying it
because this happened between me and the wife. I think it's the wife that told him to say that. So even as he is speaking wisdom, wise counsel to you, you think you get what is getting on your nerves, because you already have a perception. Amen. Yeah. Our perception, our focus should not be on earthly things, but spiritual things. Yeah. They said that because we know that you have eternal life. How many of you here come to this church because you know that I'll be able to teach you to have an eternal life? To go to heaven. Hallelujah. It is sad that is no more our focus. Our focus is not on how we will be able to study and show ourselves approved unto God. How we are going to get into His kingdom. And we are hiding behind the grace of God, doing whatever we like. Amen. What is sad is that we are always accusing pastors. Amen. Hey, pastor. So, pastor is drinking beer. Meanwhile, while he was coming, he has prepared a beer in a fridge that is chilling for Sunday special. Hallelujah. But he is just a pastor. Maybe the Bible says only pastors don't drink. Church members drink.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. So the pastor is drinking. I'm not going to that church anymore. This pastor drinks. I'm not going to the church anymore. I hear a lot of people say that. Amen. If you feel like I shouldn't drink, why are you even drinking? Amen. And these same people, they will challenge you when you tell them that it's not good to drink. Where in the Bible it is? Then they'll begin to defend themselves with the Bible. But you, as a pastor, you are a tree. So you don't do these things. But we are humans, so we do these things. Hallelujah. Let our focus be on heaven, not on what any other man is doing in the church. Amen. Look at me. When you are here and you know that the teachings that I'm giving you is not building you spiritually for you to grow, you are free to go. Amen. Member of every Christian goes to church not for the pastor to pray for him, or not just to worship, or not just to sing, but the main reason why you are coming is to seek for God's strength and to worship Him and to do what? Go to heaven to have spiritual growth, to be able to understand the things of God. They said that these things that you are saying to us, it pains me that I was not able to break it down to that level. They said that these things that you are saying to us, it is hard to understand. Amen. It was hard for them to understand the things of God. Things that would take them to heaven, it was hard for them to understand. What we understand is how you are going to pray for us and money will come in our pockets. How you are going to pray for us that we will get that job that we are seeking for. How you are going to pray for us that we will begin to prosper. Hallelujah. Hey, yes, pastor, he's powerful. As soon as I went to his church, he prayed for me. My son was sick and he was healed. I was seeking for a job, and I got a job. That is how we rate people as powerful. Amen. But are they building you spiritually for eternal life? Amen. Are they even teaching you about eternal life? They said that we believe that you have eternal life. Amen. And we believe, they don't only believe that he has eternal life, but they also believe in him. Amen. Pains me that because of time, I've taken much of your time, but I guess I should have break it into two and give you the first sermon and the second sermon, I think. Next week, I will come back and then break it down how they could not understand spiritual things, hallelujah. How they could not understand things that would take them to eternal life, amen. But it was easy for them for the first time to understand and come back and say that teach us how to do the works of God.
Amen.
Because they got food to eat. They got bread. They got fish. So they came back and said, teach us. Amen. But when they had no more, but the only thing that he had is Jesus. The only thing that he had, he said, I have offered myself to you. They begin to despise him. He said, is this not a carpenter's son? Is this not Joseph's son? The same people that were looking up to him for him to teach them how to do the works of God, they begin to despise him. When he offered them the most precious gifts on this earth, because they had the wrong perception. Turn to your brother and say, change your perception. Stand on your feet.
I need you. I need you. Every hour I need you. Oh, bless me now, my Savior. I come to
to go.
you also. Thank you, Jesus. Father, I pray in the mighty name of Jesus. The Bible says that we shall make a decree and it shall be established. I decree that every spirit of provocation that is provoking us to go against the word of God, every spirit of provocation that provokes us against our husbands and our children and our wives, every spirit of provocation that provokes our authorities against us, every spirit of provocation we subdue, we come against, we resist in the name of Jesus. The Bible says that we should resist the devil and he will flee. We resist every spirit of provocation in the mighty name of Jesus. And we pray that Lord, you will grant us understanding, guide us, lead us into the paths of righteousness, that you read our thoughts in the name of Jesus that we pray. Amen. Amen. Put your hands together for our mighty God.
Amen. What do you say to Pastor? God bless you, Pastor. That was very powerful, nice teachings. Hallelujah. Our perceptions and expectations. Hallelujah. Amen. It's one of fortunate. That is the focal point of our Christian life at the moment. Amen. I remember one man of God. That was way back in Virginia. Before he started preaching, he sounds a warning that if your expectations of coming to church this Sunday is to get this job or this money, then you are the wrong place. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That was his warning that he sounded before he started going through the Bible. Hallelujah. Like I said, it has been a focal point of our Christian life at the moment. Hallelujah. We always expect to seek something. We need to see something in reality. Hallelujah. God bless you so much, Pastor, for that wonderful teachings. Amen. Alan Apostle has got some announcements to make. Amen.
God bless you. Amen. There's just two announcements that we're going to have the Christmas program, a night of jubilation, Unlimited Grace Prayer Ministry, and Hands-On Empowerment Resource Center. It's going to be on Saturday, December the 17th. So I'm asking everybody to come and be a part. We're definitely going to need Unlimited Praise to come because we're going to have the feast and the entertainment. Amen. Amen. Y'all not excited? Amen. Because we're going to bless the community. We're going to give out food boxes. We're going to give out toys. We're going to give out some other things that's been donated. I am asking the women of Unlimited Grace and men, if y'all cook. I know most of y'all, the wives do the cooking. So I already talked with Mavis and Linda. And I'll get with Doreen. And also Mother Cecilia. We're not going to have a whole lot of food. We got people donating food, so we won't have to do a lot of cooking. But I am asking everybody to come out. If you can come out on December the 14th or the 15th, I'll let you know before time. If you can just come out for about an hour or so, we're going to need you all to come out and help pack the bags, the food boxes, because we're going to have a lot of food, so we plan on giving out at least about 200 food boxes. Hopefully this year, like last year, we had about almost 130 some people in this building. So we believe in God, because we have another church that have partnered with us as well. So I definitely need your support. coming out, because this is unlimited grace, amen. We're giving back to the community, amen. So I will let you all know. Second announcement, women, I'm asking you all to come out and to support me. Sorry, men, you're not invited. It's a women empowerment. I would love for you to come out, but it's just for women, amen. And the information is on a poster board back there. So if you all can come out, I'm going to be the guest speaker, empowering the women. It's going to be a tourist station on December the 3rd. That's this Saturday coming up. The tickets is $35. That's going to be for dinner, fashion show, hair show, and actually it's going to be two guest speakers, myself and another doctor from Florida. So see me at the church if you'd like to get a ticket. Please come out and support, amen, because we are empowering one another, okay? So that's the two announcements, and I'll go ahead and give it back to Minister David. Amen. Thank you.
Amen. I believe our announcement